In this task, we will look at basic properties of the social networks from two different villages in rural India. These data are part of a much larger data set that was collected to study diffusion of microfinance, and the findings of the study were published in an article called The Diffusion of Microfinance in the journal Science in 2013. In short, a census of households was conducted, and a subset of individuals was asked detailed questions about the relationships they have with others in the village. This information was used to create networks for each village. Basic information for all households and all surveyed individuals was also collected. The structure of connections in a network can be captured in what is known as the adjacency matrix of the network. If we have n nodes, this is an n by n matrix where entry ij is 1 if node I and node j have a tie between them. Otherwise, that entry is equal to 0. The graphs we're dealing with are called undirected, which means that a tie between nodes I and j can just as well be described as a tie between nodes j and I. Consequently, the adjacency matrix is symmetric. That means that the element ij is always the same as the element ji. Either both are 0 or both are equal to 1. We provide the adjacency matrix files for the two villages as CSV files. We will first read in the network adjacency matrices and construct the networks. Here, np.loadText is used to read in the CSV files the adjacency matrices. We will first import numpy as np. We'll be using the np.loadText function to read in the file. The first argument is going to be the file name, which looks a little bit complicated. And the second argument is going to be delimiter. In this case, it's a comma, so we set that equal to a comma. And make sure to surround the comma with quotes. We will call this A1. Then we have our second adjacency matrix, A2, which corresponds to village 2. And we can now run these three lines of code. Our next step will be to convert the adjacency matrices to graph objects. We will accomplish that by using the toNetworkXGraph method. So G1, the graph that corresponds to A1, is equal to nx.toNetworkXGraph A1. And G2 will be the graph object that is constructed from the adjacency matrix called A2. Although networks can be quite complex, we can measure some of their properties using simple numbers. To get a basic sense of the network size and number of connections, let's count the number of nodes and the number of edges in the networks. In addition, each node has a total number of edges, its degree. Let's also calculate the mean degree for all nodes in the network. We'll write this up as a function. We'll call this basic net stats. The only input is going to be our graph G. We're interested in looking at number of nodes. We're also interested in number of edges. And finally, we're interested in the mean degree. So we first extract the g.degree dictionary. We look at its values. We convert that to a list. Let's use the print function to print out the statistics to our user. This is number of nodes. This is our number of edges. And finally, the last line is our average or mean degree. And we can print that with two decimal places. And since we're printing out the average degree, we need to be sure to compute the average of the items on the list. We can then run the function, and then we can call it on G1 and on G2. In G1, we have 843 nodes, 3,400 edges, and the average degree is about 8. We can then run it on G2, which corresponds to a network in a different village. And in this case, we have 877 nodes, about 3,100 edges, and the average degree is slightly smaller, approximately equal to 7. Let's then plot the degree distribution from these two villages. First G1, then G2, and we'll have to save this as village_hist.pdf. We can try finding that plot here. And in this case, we have degree distributions from the two different villages shown here, one on top of the other. Notice how the degree distributions look quite different from what we observed for the ER networks. It seems that most people have relatively few connections, whereas a small fraction of people have a large number of connections. This distribution doesn't look at all symmetric, and its tail extends quite far to the right. This suggests that the ER graphs are likely not good models for real-world social networks. In practice, we can use ER graphs as a kind of reference graph by comparing their properties to those of empirical social networks. More sophisticated network models are able to capture many of the properties that are shown by real-world networks, but we will not go into those details here.